the Barbara Walters Special.
Don't know that I will, but until I can find.
In 1967, a young singer named Neil Diamond sang his first hit on American Bandstand.
I'll be what I am.
Kentucky woman, she shine with her own kind of light.
In the 2 years which followed, Neil Diamond had a string of hits. Six of his first singles went to the top of the music charts. His songs were sentimental and introspective. He once called himself the Will Rogers of pop music.
Kentucky woman, she get to know you.
Now, Neil Diamond was born in Brooklyn and attended NYU pre-med school. He started writing songs, you tell me, when he was 15 years old.
And it wasn't long before the young man from the Coney Island section of Brooklyn was a national star.
Here is Neil Diamond.
Hands, touching hands, reaching out, touching me, touching you.
Every one of Neil's first 27 albums sold over a million, making for an impressive collection of gold and platinum lining his office walls. In 1971, he even had four top-selling albums at one time.
It was a hot August night.
But no album was more associated with Diamond than the one he recorded live at the Greek Theater in Los Angeles. His 1971 hit, I Am, I Said, which Neil describes as his most autobiographical work, was part of that album.
I am, I cry. I am, said I. And I am lost, and I can't even say why. Leaving me lonely still.
But the most recorded song of all he's written is still this one.
Song, song, blue. Everybody knows one. Song, song, blue. Every garden grows one.
Last year, Neil Diamond was named to the Songwriters Hall of Fame, joining the likes of Irving Berlin and George Gershwin. It's a distinction given only to songwriters who've had 20 successful years in the business. Neil Diamond has had a hit almost every year since he started singing, from Solitary Man to his most recent hit, the song dedicated to E.T., Heartlight.
Turn on your heartlight in the middle of a young boy's dream. Don't wake me up too soon. We're gonna take a ride across the moon, you and me.
Neil lives in California, but he chooses not to be part of the Hollywood scene. He's a loner. He almost never does interviews, and he prides himself on what he calls a normal life. He has been married to his second wife, Marcia, for 16 years, and he says she's the inspiration for all of his love songs.
Every aspect of being in love, being jealous, being angry, being passionate, all of these things come from my experiences with her.
Turn on your heart light now. Turn on your heart light now. Turn on your heart.
Start out wanting to be a performer?
No. The furthest out thought that I could possibly have at the age of 16 was that maybe I could write songs. I had started to write songs at that age, and I thought, boy, wouldn't it be wonderful if I could really become a good songwriter and do this as my life's work.
For someone else?
Write for other people, sure.
You dropped out of college in your senior year.
Well, I had an offer I couldn't turn down. I got an offer from a music publishing company that was basically a Broadway music company, and they offered me $40 a week to write songs. And I thought, my goodness, these people are going to pay me to do this. I love it. And I realized at that point that I was not going to be a doctor. I was just barely scraping by in school. And so I took the job and I quit school.
Now, for several years, you wrote, tried to write songs for others.
Yeah.
And did not make it. That's terrible. The understatement.
It was terrible.
You were terrible.
Nothing.
Why?
I didn't know enough.
Did they fire you?
I was fired many times, yeah. I was fired from just about every place I worked.
So how did you know you were any good?
I didn't know I was any good, but there was nothing else that I had. I didn't know anything else, and I didn't think I was good until people started to take notice, you know, and say, oh, that's interesting, or I love the lyric on that, or, you know, and then they began to say, after I'd made dozens and dozens and dozens of demos, they began to say, hey, you could sing that, you know, you should sing it.
You said, who, me?
I said, you know, well, wait a minute, I really don't want to sing it. I want Bobby V to sing it, or, you know, I want Bobby Darin to sing it.
What was the first time that you walked out in front of an audience and sang? What did you sing? What did you wear? And what were you like?
I got my first professional job in Florida. I had a record out, a record called Solitary Man. And it actually happened in a few cities. A couple of radio stations played it, and it started to make some noise. I got a call from an agent, and he said, some promoter in Florida wants you to come down for the weekend and do 6 performances over the weekend. And I didn't know any other songs except this particular song that was on the record.
But you had to do 6 times?
Well, I had to do it 6 times, 2 times a night in different cities. You drive to the city, you go up in front
of
the audience.
You just sang one song.
I had to fill it up. I had to fill it up. I had a couple of songs that I knew from camp, you know, If I Had a Hammer and La Bamba. Literally did that. I did that at the Hollywood Bowl once. I was booked there. Those are the only 3 songs I knew: Solitary Man, If I Had a Hammer, and La Bamba.
It's a rather limited.
It was limited, but that was all they wanted. Sing 3 songs. So I got up there. I went for, as soon as I heard about this, I went down to Greenwich Village, and I bought myself a beautiful suit, you know. And
black?
No, I didn't know black yet. It was like, I think it was a gray suit with like red pinstripes and wide lapels.
Simple,
and it was
in quiet good taste.
I didn't know anything. I didn't know who I was on stage. I didn't know what I was supposed to project, you know.
And when they applauded...
If they applaud, I don't remember that part of it. I think I may have blocked
maybe
it from my
mind. Maybe for La Bamba
mind.
They applauded.
I thought just the fact that I survived those shows was good.
You used your real name.
Yeah. I had some doubt about it because before Solitary Man came out, I thought, I can't use Neil Diamond. It's too normal. It's boring. It's ordinary. And Diamond sounds like somebody made it up. And I have to find a name with some character to it, something that will be memorable. And so I came up with 2 names, and I gave them into the record company. And they called me just before the record was pressed, and they said, well, is it going to be Neil Diamond? Is it going to be Noah Kaminsky, which was one of the alternates that I had? Or is it going to be Ice Cherry?
Ice Cherry.
Ice Cherry. Yeah. E-I-C-E.
E-I-C-E. Cherry.
Yes,
very
which
catchy.
I thought, wow, that sounds really cool.
Most people named Noah Kaminsky would want to change it to Neil Diamond.
Neil Diamond.
You wanted
was,
to be a little more ethnic.
Well, I thought there was something biblical about it. There was some character to it, and I chickened out the last minute. I mean, the president of the company called me and he said, well, what is it, Neil? And I thought of my grandmother, and I said, my goodness, I could never explain it to her.
How you could be Ice Cherry.
Who is this? This is me. No, it's not you. So I said, go with Neil Diamond, then I'll try and figure it out after that. And, you know, it worked out okay.
But your friends all call you Ice for short.
Very few people know that story until now, but it was very close. You were almost doing an interview with Ice Cherry and explaining why I changed my name.
When you had made it, when you were on Broadway in 1972, and everything was, at least it seemed, pretty terrific.
Yeah, it was.
You stopped cold and took 4 years off.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Why?
Well, I didn't plan to take 4 years. I planned to take 1 year. I said, I've been on the road for 6 or 7 years, and I need a year off just to see what real life is like.
But was it a period, as I've heard, of great introspection, of analysis?
Mm-hmm. Yes, I said, I'm going to do something very productive, and I read all the books that I wanted to read. I signed up with an analyst, and I said, here, you know, take
Why?
Me, talk to me. Because I'd never had the chance or the time to do that or could afford to do that before. And I started going, and, you know, he wanted to talk about dreams, and I've never remembered my dreams. So we started talking about my lyrics, which he said were very much like dreams.
What about I am, I said?
Yeah. It's hard to speak, but the lyric says, did you ever read about a frog who dreamed of being a king and then became one? Well, except for the names and a few other changes, if you talk about me, the story's the same one. But
go on.
But I've got an emptiness deep inside, and I've tried, but it won't let me go. And I'm not a man who likes to swear, but I've never cared for the sound of being alone. I am, I said. It was a tough song to write because I had to look into myself to be truthful about it. It was a difficult song, probably the most difficult song I've ever written, and maybe the most worthwhile song I've ever written.
What are you today, the frog or the king?
I'm neither. I realized a long time ago that I was not about to be a king, and I'm not a frog either. I'm a human being. I hurt. I love. I feel guilt. I love to be accepted by people because, in a sense, it's an extension of myself. But I'm neither.
But you do write a lot about an emptiness that can't be filled, a loneliness. I mean, that's
yes,
not
that's
just
true.
That's not just made up because it's effective in songs, because it has to come
yes,
from you.
That's true. That's a theme that runs through many of my songs, the solitary idea, the loneliness, mm-hmm. and that part of it hasn't gotten any better, especially since I've become well known, because a celebrity is separated from everybody else, you know? You're not included. People don't include you as part of them, with them. You're separated, you're apart. They put you on a pedestal or they put you in a spotlight, you know? So there is that, no question about it, that loneliness. Of course, the fact that I have a family and I have kids that love me and I have a wife that loves me, you know, that's what I hold on to.
Now, after the years of insecurity or anxiety, do you feel now that you've made it?
Well, I mean, it's, in a sense, I have made it, and I felt from the moment that I was able to earn a living as a writer that I had made it. And not only that, but lots of people like my songs, and a lot of people come in to listen to me sing, and people respect my work, and I don't think I could ask for more. I never dreamed that it would happen, and it's, you know, it's everything that I could ever imagine wanting.
It's a beautiful noise.
Well, I want to keep it beautiful.
What a beautiful noise coming into my room. And it's begging for me just to give it a tune.